My name is Andrew Subin, one of the founding partners of Vermont Cannabis Solutions. We're here to answer your cannabis questions.
I'm Tim Fair, the other half of Vermont Cannabis Solutions, also here to answer questions, maybe talk a little bit about what we've been missing over the last 2 months in the world of cannabis.
Awesome. So, back when we all went into hiding, S.54 was making its way through the legislature. Where did it stop, and where are we now?
Well, we were that close on S.54 right before the whole shutdown. At this point, the bill had passed the Senate, as we all know, multiple times. It had finally passed the House, which was a landmark. Never had gotten through the Vermont House of Representatives before. So that was huge. And right before the shutdown, a committee was formed which would reconcile the two bills.
Yeah, and so we felt like we were right on the verge of watching this happen after a long time to wait. And of course, COVID has stopped everything. The legislature pretty much has turned to working on COVID issues. But House Speaker Mitzi Johnson has said recently that they plan to get back to non-COVID matters as soon as they can, hopefully later this summer. And that would include resuming with the cannabis legalization bill.
There have been three pre-COVID bills that have been talked about quite a bit. The climate change bill, the Act 250 modifications, and the cannabis bill. So that is promising. Cautious optimism that we may still see this thing get to the governor's desk. And I think that's going to be the real question now, is what Phil Scott is going to do with this bill, because I think this the political dynamics have changed significantly.
Looking at S.54 from as objective a perspective as possible, what piece of the legislation do you like? What piece of the legislation would you like to see improved? It seems to me there's two arguments. One is it's kind of bill, we should can it and wait for perfect. Kind of bill, pass the fucker and let's get on with it. And getting your sense of how you feel about that. But let's talk about maybe we start with that, and then we can talk about specifically where you feel the bill is strong, where you feel the bill is weak, and where you feel the bill has been misrepresented.
Well, I mean, the challenge in that is that until reconciliation occurs, we don't know what the bill is.
Right, okay.
You know, we have two very different versions of the bill. We have the House bill, we have the Senate bill. There's some similarities, there's some wildly divergent.
Well, then let's back up and say that, because I think that's something that a lot of people don't recognize.
Right.
Okay. The elements that were in the bill. I think there's a lack of understanding about where it was in the process. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. The Senate had passed a bill, and the House had passed a different bill. The Senate bill passed first. The House made a number of changes to the bill that was passed by the Senate. So when the legislature locked down for COVID, we were at a point where the Senate had passed a version of S-54. The House had also passed a version of S-54. Those two versions of the bill are not the same. And so what has to happen is the two versions have to be reconciled. And that takes a committee of some members from the House, some members from the Senate, and this committee gets together and hammers out the differences between the two bills. That has not happened yet. The committee has been formed. The members of that committee have been appointed, but that committee hasn't yet met and done any work. So we don't know when the bill is reconciled exactly which version is going to make it to the full House for a full floor vote.
Now, there were some pieces in the bill that we felt were in both versions of the bill that seemed strong. There were differences that made one version weaker than the other. What are the pieces that you liked about this?
Well, you know, the pieces that I liked about this is that after all of these years, we're ending the vacuum that we have right now. And some of the most controversial parts of this bill, such as the saliva testing for roadside impairment, such as the classification as a non-agricultural activity for the purpose of local zoning. A lot of these issues were not in both parts of the bill, so are still up, or toss up. We don't know whether they're going to be implemented or not. My favorite part of this bill is establishing a cannabis control board and moving forward, because we need to move forward. At this point, we have, for the last 2 years now, had a legalized substance of no way to purchase it. We have a dearth of statutory guidance about how to move forward with the industry. We have a lot of people who want to be on the right side of the law. I'm not sure where that line is. And we have a growing black market, which is detrimental to the industry as a whole. So, you know, my position on this is that, is it a perfect bill? No. There is no perfect legislation. No bill has ever been passed. No law in the history of a legislator has ever been passed that is perfect. Legislation by nature is compromise. You cannot get something through without compromising, without reaching agreements on both sides, which means inherently there are going to be aspects we don't like. There is also a lot of misunderstanding about what some of these provisions actually mean. What they sound like and what they really mean are two different things. The classification as an agricultural versus non-agricultural activity, for example, is a prime example of one that people heard about. And what do you mean it's not farming? It's farming! It's a zoning issue. This is a zoning issue, and it really is a very small matter.
Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to add that one issue that is in both versions of the bill that has been controversial, but is likely to make it into a final version of the bill, is what people have called a head start for the existing medical dispensaries. So what both versions of the bill say about that is that the existing medical dispensaries will get a retail license for a period of 5 months before other people can get retail licenses. So it is true, the dispensaries will have that 5 month head start on starting their retail sales. There's historical reasons for that, there's political reasons for that. I put that in the category of something that maybe is part of a compromise and something that I maybe wish wasn't part of the bill, but at this point, the reality is that that is going to be part of the bill. 5 months, I don't believe, is a very long time. I don't believe it's long enough to give them a lasting monopoly over retail sales. I think that a lot of people who are interested in retail are going to need every hour and minute of time that they have to get themselves ready for a competitive license application process and to get a retail establishment open. So I can understand why there's some people who are upset about the so-called dispensary head start, but I think it's a problem that's or it's a something that's worth accepting to get to a tax and regulate system.
One of the concerns I've had from the smaller growers is the feeling like, yes, they can sell to the dispensaries immediately, but that the dispensaries would not prioritize or elevate what they had to offer, maybe even if they'd been in conflict with the dispensary, so that, yeah, they'll sell it, but they'll stick it on the back shelf and I won't get fair market value.
Think about this for a minute. The dispensaries currently are forced vertical integration, meaning they need to grow everything. They can barely grow enough on their own to support the 5,000 patients. The Rand Report estimates 80,000 adult use patients in the first month once we open up an adult use system. So if they can't grow enough cannabis for 5,000 people but have 80,000 customers, are they going to be able to back burner small growers' cannabis? Or are they going to be desperately buying up every bit they can with the grower setting the price? Because basic economics, supply and demand. And the supply will be coming from the growers. The growers will be the ones who have the power in this. Now granted, once everything levels up and we have larger commercial grows, we're gonna see that balance shift and even out a little bit. But when I hear growers say that the dispensaries are not gonna be buying or lowballing them, I mean, that just doesn't make any logical sense.
I agree, and I think the argument that the dispensaries are going to be reluctant in the beginning to sell other cultivators' product is, again, not understanding that they have to think more long-term than that. These retail locations are going to have to, or they're going to want to, develop relations with the growers that they think are growing the best products. And the market is going to demand. People who are making this argument maybe haven't been to a lot of retail shops in Seattle or in Denver or in Los Angeles. Because when you go into those shops, the customer expects variety, not Champlain Valley, and that's all you get. I want to see 100 different varieties from 100 different growers, if possible. And so I think there's a real market need. You know, these people are going to be running these first dispensaries. They're going to have to develop long-term relationships with the local growers, and that's going to be of utmost priority to them. And of course, if you've got a long-standing beef with these guys and they won't sell your stuff, I'm not going to sit here and say that will never happen, but it's only 5 months, and there's going to be plenty of retail locations for you to place your stuff that where you won't have to deal with the dispensary. So I agree with Tim. These first retail stores that are run by
Maine just dropped.
So there's a lot of runarounds, they're not very effective, and generally will lose in any constitutional challenge, which can put cause litigation to hold things up. Residence requirements are not a great idea. What is a great idea is limiting everybody to one license. So if there is a corporate entity which gets a license, great, you don't like them, don't sell them. But Trulieve or Pureleaf or MedMen or any of these big companies can't monopolize because they can only hold one. So you don't like them, go ahead and sell to one of our clients. Who are local, who also have one license, one retail, and you can vertically integrate, so you can have your grow cultivation, and you can process, and you can retail, and hold one of each license. What you can't do is horizontally integrate, which means buying all the licenses, or getting all the licenses, or holding a monopoly. So I've never really understood where this whole corporate takeover concept has come from, because it's simply just not true.
I agree with Tim on that answer as far as the cultivation and big corporate cultivation coming in. Same is true, I think, of retail and the idea of one of these big multi-state cannabis corporations coming and getting a retail license here is not a huge worry, because there's going to be so relatively few retail licenses given out. There's not going to be a requirement for Vermont residency, but part of your whole application plan is going to be explaining why you've chosen this town and why you've chosen this building and why cannabis is good for this town. And by the way, the town already supports it. And so it's going to be difficult for a big out-of-state operator to put together an application that's compelling.
For one retail location.
For one retail location. You know, these companies want five retail stores in a state.
30. What they're doing in Florida right now, every license holder can have 25 stores, but people are jumping all over that right now. Even New York, they can have 4. That's still limited. One in Vermont.
Now that that being said, I think there will be, there will be some out-of-state money coming into Vermont, into the cannabis industry, and I don't think that's an entirely bad thing. I mean, in any other industry, if we were saying, boy, we're going to bring in a lot of out-of-state investment, people are going to be wanting to come and start companies in Vermont and hire people to work for their companies. Why is that viewed as a negative? No, we don't want corporate cannabis companies from California and Colorado to come and take over our industry. But it's going to take capital to build these retail stores. It's going to take experience. And these people have experience running cannabis businesses for years. They're good workers. You might want to hire them as part of your staff, if nothing else. So the extent to which outside money and outside people are coming into Vermont to help with cannabis, that's not entirely a negative thing. It could be a good thing for
us. It's not a zero-sum game. It's not all Vermont or all corporate takeover. That's silly. That's simply not the case. Will there be some outside investment? Sure. Will there be some mom-and-pop operations who are bootstrapped? Sure. Will there be room enough for both? Absolutely. because again, the single license scheme, which is in both the Senate and House bills, that is exactly why that is there, is to prevent the very thing that a lot of people are concerned about. Again, is it perfect? No. Do we want to be going back to the drawing board again on this one? It's never going to be perfect.
One other question. So some people have expressed concern that a cannabis control board is not the way to go and that it should really be the Agency of Agriculture who's overseeing all of this. What's your response to that?
My response to that, I asked that question to Carrie Guerre, who's, of course, most people listening to this probably know Carrie or know who he is. He's our hemp and cannabis guy at the Agency of Agriculture. We friends of the show. We love Carrie. So. But I asked him that question, and he said, and I agree, I don't think it makes ultimately that much difference. The Agency of Agriculture could create a cannabis division and staff it, and it's going to be staffed with people who are going to try to get the cannabis industry going. You know, those people who are qualified to staff a cannabis control division of the Agency of Agriculture, whether they have their own their own mini agency, which is the Cannabis Control Board, ultimately I don't think makes that much difference.
I have yet to hear why a Cannabis Control Board is so bad. A valid reason, other than some paranoia, tin foil hat crap. When coming from the perspective of an attorney and an advocate who fully intends to be in front of this board 90% of our time once it's formed, and knowing how state government works, working with a board such as the Liquor Control Board or the Cannabis Control Board gives you a set group of people, personalities, who you get to know. You get to know very well. The same people, the same patterns, the same procedures, the same policies. It becomes very easy to work with. Now, working with an entire state agency, like the Department of Agriculture, for example, even if they did have a separate cannabis, you still have the head of the department, you have the head of the agency. They're a political agency. They're subject to political forces. They have a lot on their plate. They take in a great deal of federal funds, which theoretically could be threatened in a different administration by the facilitation of a controlled substance. They are, there's a multitude of reasons why that would present more challenges than a simple five-person board. People are worried about back room, smoky room dealing. That just doesn't make any sense. All of Vermont is subject to public meeting laws. There's open transparency. And if there was anything going on untoward, this is not Massachusetts. This is not Michigan. This is not, we're in Vermont. And if something sketchy is going on, we're going to know about it. We're going to call them out. Have some faith in the people that are on our side on this one. But not to have anything, we are still defending people being charged with felonies. We are still defending medical patients who are being charged, who are being caught up in the criminal justice system. We are still trying to give entrepreneurs advice on how best to pursue their businesses without any clear guidance. These are very, very dangerous pitfalls for people. It makes people get out of the industry. It makes us lose funding. It makes the industry go down. And if there's nobody here, who will fill the vacuum when it eventually happens?
And so it sounds to me, too, like to not pass the bill, to try to go back to square one in the hopes of getting something perfect, leaves a lot of people behind for a much longer period of time.
High and dry. A lot of people are going to go out of business. A lot of this way, it's going to hurt the people who supposedly are most important, which is the small Vermont mom and pop, small entrepreneur, small business, because they're the ones who can least afford more delay.
And the criminal justice side of things, too.
And the criminal justice side of things. We still have people getting arrested. We still have no clarity. We still have the black market growing. We still have, all of these factors that are going to only get worse and make it more difficult, make it less likely. We've got the best bill we're going to see. We've been at this for over 5 years. Why some people think that we're going to scrap this and all of a sudden the legislature is going to come up with something that's just wonderful. Yes, I don't think the government should be regulating cannabis. I think anybody should be able to grow cannabis anywhere. I think you should be able to grow it in your backyard. I think you should be able to sell it at your stand. I don't think we need any of this government regulation. But that is not reality. That's not reality. Reality is that We still have 40% of the state against legalization. We still have a strong contingent of prohibitionists, some of them holding very high positions in state government. And if this is going to happen, there need to be compromises. This bill makes compromises. Some are good, some are not so good, they're workable. And what's not good, we can start working to advocate to make changes immediately. But if we don't have it, we don't have a board, we don't have anything.
So,
but see, I mean, I think I would add to that, that not passing a bill as soon as we can, considering everything that's happened with COVID and the lockdown and coming out of the lockdown now, we've been handed an opportunity to get ahead of New York and to get ahead of New Jersey. Boy, that governor of New York, he's a pretty sharp guy. I think everybody can see that. He was all gangbusters about legalization for New York. We, if you think about cannabis regionally, we have got to legalize before New York in Vermont. And we've been, it's been handed to us on a platter. New York is not doing it this year. He said so. We can still do it this year. And boy, what if we don't, what a missed opportunity.
We've already lost out millions of dollars in tax revenue to Massachusetts. We have unknown amount of dollars floating from Vermont to Massachusetts. We have missed dollars from tourists coming up buying in Massachusetts before they get to Vermont on their vacations. We've lost one all out for the last 2 years. We don't want to lose out anymore. Because eventually, if we just keep kicking this can down the road and we keep saying, ah, it's not good enough, it's not good enough, it's not good enough, what is going to happen is these corporate cannabis companies are going to come in eventually. They're going to fill the vacuum and they are going to take over because there won't be anybody else left. And that scares me. I don't want to be back on square one on this. We've worked way too hard. We've come way too far. This is the time to get this thing done. You know, and it's just, that's the reality of the situation. Let's get it done. Let's move forward.
I have one last question. Did you intentionally match the color of your shirt to this beautiful bong by Tito?
Yes. Yes, I checked and said, what are we going to be doing in the middle of it? No, I don't know.
It's pretty spot on, I guess.
If people have questions for you guys, what's the best way to get in touch?
Feel free to give us a call. Check out our website, VermontCannabisSolutions.com. 540-WEED is our phone number. We are transitioning back to the office, and we're always happy to take calls. Can you email either myself or Andrew at Tim or Andrew at VermontCannabisSolutions.com. Try to keep it easy. Stop by the office. Say hello.
And I would say this is the first time we've done one of these spots. We hope to do a lot more. You can find these on the Heady Vermont website. You can also find these on the Vermont Cannabis Solutions website. Look for us on Instagram and Facebook and stuff. And we look. If you have topics that you'd like us to hear us talk about, please send us an email and we'll be happy to address whatever questions you might be interested in hearing.
Excellent. Thanks so much, you guys.